Good afternoon all. Welcome to our web series. Today we continue our last topic, that's on the inlets, nozzles and the combustion chamber. As we discussed in the last class, we have some commonality between these components. That's why we tried to make this into one module. These are the static components, inlets, nozzles and the combustion chamber. And other thing is, inlets and the nozzles are more or less the fundamentals or the working principles are same. Whatever we understood in the last class, that's useful for today's class. In the last class, we spent more time on the inlets, which are also called as the intakes, aircraft intakes. We spent time in understanding the different types of the intakes that's useful for the subsonic and the supersonic flights. And we also tried to understand the complexity of the supersonic flights, what the phenomenon or physical phenomenon, what happened in the supersonic flights. Today we will spend more time on the nozzles or exhaust nozzles basically. And in the next session, we will try to cover on the combustion chamber. This is the contents what we started yesterday. In the last class, we covered up to here, different types of inlets. Then we spent time on the subsonic inlets, then supersonic inlets. Today, we will spend some more time on the nozzles, exhaust nozzles. And this is the schematic diagram what we have discussed in yesterday's class also. This is the intake or inlets, and these are the combustion chamber, and this corresponds to the exhaust nozzle, and other components are the compressor and the turbine. As I mentioned, these are the static components basically, inlet, combustor and the exhaust nozzle. We tried to understand something on the inlet portion yesterday, and today we will concentrate on the last part in the engine, that is the nozzle, exhaust nozzle. Exhaust nozzles, as the name indicates, it is used for the exhausting the combustor gases, hot flue gases, and then we want to convert the very high temperature gases. We send the very high temperature gases into the nozzles, and where we convert the energy, thermal energy, into the velocity. So nozzles are meant for increasing the velocity. So that's where we get the thrust. As you all know that for getting the thrust, for aircraft thrust, we need to have the very high velocity jets. So the main function of the nozzle is creating the high velocity jet. So thereby we get the thrust force required for the flight. And you all know that the thrust force is not uniform, not constant for all the phases. It changes from phase to phase. During the takeoff, you need a different thrust. During the climb, different thrust. Cruise and the landing, all these require the different thrust. So our nozzles should be designed in such a way that it caters all the needs of the thrust force. In turbo propellers, nozzles may be generate, it's a kind of a generate part of the total thrust. That's we discussed in the last portion. Turbo propeller, basically, propeller is the main component which creates the thrust, and but the exhaust gases will leave the nozzle, so that also creates some thrust. So turbo propellers, nozzles also will help in getting the thrust. Not only the propeller, exhaust nozzle creates some thrust. And in the exhaust duct or exhaust nozzle, the main components are the tailpipe and the tail cone or tail cone. It's a very simple nozzle. And as in the intakes, nozzles also in the different geometries. Some geometries are the fixed geometries and some other are the variable geometry configuration. As we saw in yesterday's class, generally for the subsonic we prefer to go for the fixed geometries, even though some flights they go for the variable geometry, but majorly we go for the fixed geometry. Similarly, for subsonic flights we generally go for the fixed geometry, and whereas in the supersonic flights, that's for the fighters, combat vehicles, we go for the variable geometry. So where you can create the thrust in the different different requirements. And other major function is to creating the vectoring. This we discussed sometime back, you know, thrust vectoring. So whenever a fighter needs maneuvering, it uses the vectoring, thrust vectoring. So this is also one of the function for the nozzles. And apart from that, the nozzles also gives the compartment for suppressing the noise, exhaust noise control. Yeah, here this shows the schematic diagram of the exhaust nozzle. This is the fixed geometry. For the time being, we are just showing the fixed geometry. This portion, as you know, that a nozzle means it is the portion after your turbine. So this is the turbine part. And after the turbine, we have the exhaust nozzle. This is a nozzle. And for the subsonic, we all know that generally the jet velocity is the subsonic, that's a Mach number is less than 1. So we don't require the CD nozzle, we require the converging nozzle. You can see the cross section here, it is more here. As it moves here, the cross section comes down. So this is called as the converging duct, converging nozzle. Whereas in the supersonic you will see the contoured converging diverging nozzle, where we require the high velocities here. Mach number is more than 1. To get the high Mach numbers, the converging nozzle is sufficient. Converging nozzle is not sufficient. We need to go for the converging diverging nozzle. So this is the nozzle portion. And just before the nozzle, we have some straight pipe. So that pipe we call that as the tail pipe. So basically this entire thing we call that as the part of the nozzle. So nozzle contains the tail pipe and the actual nozzle section. Here this shows the kind of the variable geometry here. You can see here the dotted lines here. So the geometry can vary from this shape to this shape. Okay, based on the requirement to get the more efficiency and all. More efficiency and more thrust, based on the thrust requirement, the shape of the nozzle will change. Even though it's converging, but the converging angle will change. And CD nozzles also, there will be change in the geometry. That's useful. We will see more details in the consecutive slides, how it will be carried out in the real flights. And apart from that, in the supersonic flights or the jet fighters, we will have a afterburner. Afterburner is nothing but it's a secondary combustion. We know that before the turbines we have the primary combustion, and in the supersonic flights or fighters, where we need the lot of thrust and the vectoring and maneuvering, so there we need the thrust requirements keep changing. So when we require the high thrust and all, we will have a afterburner here. So this is the afterburner. Afterburner, that's a very hot gases will go through the nozzles. So we are giving the extra energy here, exhaust gases, after expanding in the turbine, again we are heating. It's a kind of reheating. Reheating, and the high temperature fluid will go through the nozzle. As we discussed, actually, these are the different types of the nozzles we use in commercial and the fighters. Convergent or converging diverging, we have seen that pictorically in the last slide. And sometimes we go for the axisymmetric. Majorly, many of the things we go for the axisymmetric, or sometimes axisymmetric or two-dimensional. And as we discussed, the some geometries are fixed geometry and some are the variable geometry. Based on the need, we can change the geometry. So for that purpose, we use the variable geometry. As you know that the simplest geometry is the fixed geometry, but thing is, it may not really cater the all the needs effectively. But generally in subsonic, majority of the subsonic commercial aircraft, we use the fixed geometries. And the as we discussed, variable geometry is also used mainly for the fighters. And they request the lot of control mechanisms to move the actuators basically. So you need, when you need to change the area, that means you need to move some of the parts. So that requires the complex actuation system in the variable geometry. But whereas in the fixed geometry, as the name says, it's a fixed one. Once the geometry cross-section is fixed, then we can't change that. But both have the benefits and drawbacks. Yeah, these are the minimum expectation from the nozzle. So that's the first thing, is it should be matched with the other engine components. This is very, very important. Second one is the provide the optimum expansion ratio. Third one is the minimum losses. The losses, separation losses, or the shock wave losses, whatever we expect in the converging, diverging. We try to minimize those losses at the design, and even if it is possible off design, but it's very, very difficult to get the same design works for the design and off design. It's very difficult unless you have the variable geometry. And other thing we have seen, afterburner, it should permit the afterburner in case it is required. And the other one is the reverse thrust. Generally, when you go for the landing, this wheel brakes is not sufficient to stop the aircraft. There we use the reverse thrust. So thrust helps to, as the name says, it's the thrust in the reverse direction. So it helps in stopping the aircraft. So that's also part of the nozzle portion. And other thing we discuss, jet noise. Basically, noise will be created because of the very high velocity fluids. But to suppress the noise, we keep the some noise absorbing material in the nozzle. So it needs to give the some space to keep the noise absorbing materials. And the IR radiation, this, for the space applications, we need this one also. And other thing is, you know, when you are using for the fighters, we should not reveal our signature. So for that purpose, this is very important. The jet which is coming out from the engine, it should not detectable. So for that purpose, this is another need for the fighters, basically, especially for the fighters. And other thing is the vector thrust. Whenever is required, whenever maneuvering is required, this is the vectoring. Vectoring means some direction. You need to change the direction. In the cruise and all, you know that that's along with the flight direction. But whenever you need the maneuvering, along with your control surfaces, this jet thrust, jet direction will change. We will see some more details in the next slides, actually, how the vectoring will happen in the nozzles. And again, this is the common requirement for all the components. Try to have the minimum weight, minimum cost, and maintenance while satisfying the above. So we always try to have the trade-offs between these requirements. One way we want to have the minimum weight, but another way we want to have the more flexibility and more maneuvering and all. It's not possible. So when it is coming to the commercial flight, definitely these makes the very, very influencing requirements. But when it comes to the fighters or the combat vehicles, they don't really care much about the weight cost and the maintenance. The performance of the engine at different missions, that's more important than these things. So again, it's a trade-off. Based on the your requirement, you need to work out which method you need to adapt and work on. Again, it's the same thing what I'm repeating. Converging nozzles generally used for the subsonic, and the CD nozzles generally used for the fighter sec, basically. Supersonic, for supersonic jets. It's again, I'm repeating the same thing. Yeah, here I'm trying to show you the variable area nozzles, different types. One is the central plug. That's the inlet also we have seen in the last class. There will be central body. That create, as the, there is the central body, it creates the shock waves, basically. That's what we have seen in the yesterday's class. Similarly, for the nozzles also, we will have the nozzle with the central plug, and some are the ejector type, and some are the iris nozzle. This is the kind of the latest technology, iris nozzle. I will show some pictures in the next slides. Again, probably you might know these expansion flow through the nozzle, CD nozzle. In the aerodynamics class, probably you could have understood that the phenomenon of the expansion, under expansion, over expansion. Maybe when it comes to the slide, I will try to explain something more. Yeah, this is the central plug. You know, this is the actual nozzle. You just see here, this portion and this portion. So this is the cross-section area, basically. But here, you are putting a plug here, central plug here. So the hot air gas from the turbines, it comes, or sometimes from the afterburner, it comes here, it goes through this annulus, and it creates the shock waves. You are reducing the cross section here, actually. Shock waves will be here. And this is the external to the nozzle. Sometimes you will have the secondary flow here, actually. The other one is the ejector nozzle. Ejector nozzle creates an effective nozzle through the secondary air flow. At subsonic speeds, it restricts the, it constricts the exhaust to a convergent shape. You just see here. So what it is trying to say is it works for the subsonic speeds also. Exhaust, when it is running with the subsonic speeds, it works like a convergent shape. As the speed increases, then it will change to CD nozzle. And some have the tertiary. Tertiary means primary, secondary, and tertiary. There are three streams, suppose. Primary is mainly comes from the combustor part. Secondary is something like bypass. Bypass air is again that bypass air. Some many of the turbofans we get the bypass also will be mixed with the primary core air, and then it goes to the nozzle. So that bypass air is treated as the secondary air, and sometimes the tertiary air, that's maybe coming from the external, that's also will be considered. Here you can see here, yeah, ejector type. Suppose when the again, this is here, it is shown for the variable geometry here. So this is your core flow. Core flow is the primary flow, which is coming from your combustor and the turbine. So this is the primary core flow. And this is the bypass flow, secondary air comes. Now you can see here, this is the nozzle portion we are creating. Here we are not really creating the nozzle portion, but here you can see we can change the shape. This is a dotted position, dotted line shows one position, and when it moves to the another position, you can see here. So this requires the actuation system. So based on the requirement, we can keep changing the shape. You can see here, suppose when the actuator is at this location, you can see here this becomes the kind of throat, and from here again it's the diverging here, you can see here. So this becomes a kind of a converging diverging, which is used for the high Mach, whereas for the low Mach number, this is a position. Even for the supersonic flight, when it is taken to take off, obviously it needs to go with the subsonic speeds. So for that, during that time, the position will be like this. When it is like this, so it goes like this, and it's a kind of the converging type. Converging means cross section will keep reducing. That's useful for the low Mach number. And when it is a high Mach number, this is a location, so you will have the converging diverging. Up to here it's a kind of converging, and here you have a throat here. From here it is the diverging. So these kind of the ejector system are used for the especially for the fighters. Even for subsonic we don't require. Basically here high Mach generally we don't require, so generally converging is good enough. And here it shows the tertiary means the third flow, third stream of the air. So this is a engine core flow, this is the secondary air flow could be from the bypass, as I mentioned. Even in the supersonic flights, there may be a slight bypass, all may not be the turbo jet engines. So there you have the low bypass turbo fans are used for the some of the fighters. There you will have the secondary airflow. And in addition, sometimes it's required, it's a kind of the blow-in doors, where you need to have the high mass flow rate with the low speed, low jet velocity. There we use the three streams of the air. So again, this shows the variable geometry. So this geometry, this location keep changing based on our requirement. We will change this. So the control system, designing a control system, actuation system plays very, very important role in designing and manufacturing this kind of the nozzles. Again, the third variety is on the iris nozzle. It's still complicated than the variable geometry, but it offers the very high performance. That means based on the need, for each need we are trying to optimize the your cross sections. So that's why we say it's the variable geometry. And this is as we discussed in the last slides, this nozzle is helpful in getting the vector thrust. So direction, you can change the directions. You can see this is the iris type. So here it is a kind of the flexible one. So based on the need, it can change the area. And again, this entire structure, you can change, you can orient, you can deflect that. You can deflect. So this is called vector thrust. So that's the flexibility with the iris type nozzles. Yeah, directing the thrust in a direction other than the parallel to the vehicle is the thrust vectoring. Vector, as the name says, it has the both magnitude and direction. Here it is, what it means is direction in addition to the parallel, it can change to the not only the parallel, other orientations also you can get through the this kind of the nozzles. So this allows the aircraft to undergo maneuvers that that conventional control surfaces like ailerons or flaps cannot provide. So what it wants to convey here is nozzle also helps in getting the vectoring. So orientation change, that's whatever the spin or the directions you want to change, you can change using the thrust vectors. Maneuvering, during especially maneuvering. This is for the combat aircraft. Provides exceptional agility and maneuvering capabilities. Yeah, this is majorly it's developed for the VSTOL. You know that VTOL or STOL. VTOL is the vertical takeoff and landing. STOL is the short takeoff and landing. So during the takeoff, it's kind of the perpendicular. It's like your rocket. The jets will hit the ground. And once it reaches to the altitude, then it will be something like normal aircraft. So that's why that's a VTOL. Sometimes it may not be perfectly vertical. For the short landing or short takeoff, it needs the lesser space compared to the conventional ones. So STOL and VTOL, especially there, definitely we need the this kind of the nozzles, iris type nozzles, thrust vectoring. So this is obviously provides you climb rates, very better climb rates, extreme maneuvers are possible. Axisymmetric nozzle thrust vectoring. Yeah, when it comes to the thrust vector controls, these are the two control systems generally used. One is the mechanical control. As the name says, in the mechanical control, entire structure will deflect. Thereby the jet direction will change. That's through the actuation system. That's majorly for we call that as the mechanical control. And the second one is the fluidic control. Here in the fluidic control, as the name says, the control is obtained from the fluid itself. So injecting the fluid or removing the fluid from the boundary layer of the primary jet, that creates the vectoring. So basically what we are conveying here is, you know, something is going through a conduit and all, it creates some boundary layer. What we do is we have the some system to suck the boundary layer or inject the fluid. Basically that's we are getting from the injecting the fluid or removing the fluid basically. So here this is not really done by the mechanical system, but it's again it's from the fluid. So that's why we call that as the fluidic vectoring. The one what we have seen iris nozzle, what I described in the last slide, that's more mechanical, but generally you go for the fluidic also. But again, understanding the fluid vectoring is very, very challenging basically. Yeah, good thing with the mechanical vectoring is it's relatively simpler. Simpler means compared to the fluidic control. But it requires the actuation system, control systems. So all that, it becomes the heavy. It needs the additional equipment. So obviously it will add weight to the system. It's heavier and complex. Even in the mechanical thrust vectoring, there are two types, internal thrust vectoring and the external thrust vectoring. As we discussed, actually maneuvering, not only control surfaces, the exhaust jet itself will provide the pitch and yaw control basically. That's the beauty with the thrust vectoring. So internal thrust generally permits the pitch control, and the external thrust provides pitch and yaw controls. Yeah, here you can just see the internal thrust vectoring. Yeah, here you have the flaps for the deflection during the thrust vectoring. Here, this is the normal cruise condition, suppose. And when the position got changed, you can see here, this portion will not change, only this flaps position will change. Flaps were brought it down here. So this is a new position now. So this will give the jet like this. So it has the other component now. In this configuration, it has the only axial direction, but now as the orientation got changed, so it makes the pitch down. So this is useful for changing the direction basically. So this is the external thrust basically. So apart from the nozzle, we are just keeping this as external to the nozzle. Flaps or pedals to be approximately deployed to affect the vector thrust. Yeah, this also we covered in the last slide. Fluidic thrust vectoring has been demonstrated successfully at the laboratory scale. One beauty of this system is it doesn't really require the big actuation systems and control mechanisms. It's you're just changing the primary jet direction by introducing injecting the fluid basically. It has the advantages, but main challenge lies in the effective control with the linear response. We need to have very knowledge about the secondary flow and the sucking, how much we need to suck or how much we need to inject into the main jet. That's the requires very important studies. And these are the two vectoring mechanisms are popular use. Apart from that, some other concepts like shock thrust vector control, co-flow, counter-flow, these are also pursued. So as the name says, co-flow means along the flow we have the secondary flow. Counter-flow means this is a flow opposite to your primary flow. These are also used in the it's in the developing stage, I feel. Here you can see this is the primary air and here you have the secondary air. So you are injecting the secondary air here. You are injecting, suppose you are injecting on one side. You are injecting on one side, the jet will deflect like this. The jet will deflect like this. So here the flow is the secondary flow or injected flow, boundary layer flow is in parallel to the your core flow. So that's why we call that as the co-flow. This is the co-flow. And whereas here, this is the primary jet or primary flow. And here the injected flow is in the opposite direction. You just see here, opposite direction here. So this way, when you are doing with this way, this is called as the counterflow thrust vectoring. Okay, so basically you are injecting some additional flow basically, or sucking or injecting the flow. This is a core flow and you are injecting something. So that creates the thrust vectoring basically. Yeah, I will pause a moment here. Till now, if there are any questions, probably I will try to give the answers and then we will continue. Please drop your questions, any clarifications, any doubts you have till now. please let me know your questions or any clarifications you want to have. We will discuss those things and go further. There is one question Abhishek is asking, what is the primary flow and what is the secondary flow? As we discuss, primary flow is nothing but the core flow. Core flow in the sense, core flow is this one. Basically, whatever is coming from the turbine, this is the core flow. And this is the turbojet engine. We don't have the bypass, but otherwise, in the turbofan engine, you all know that in addition to the core, there will be bypass air. Bypass air will not go through the compressors or the combustor and the turbine. Bypass, it goes outside the main engine, outside the main compression system. So that is called as the bypass. That is the kind of the secondary flow. So this is the core flow, and the outside the core flow is the secondary flow. Hope it answers your question. Here, I don't have the picture for the bypass. You know that we have discussed in the class bypass engines, how it will be and all. So all that whatever is coming from the turbine and all, it is the core flow or primary flow. Whatever is coming outside the your combustor, outside your turbine, that's the bypass flow. That's the secondary flow. There is another question. Does commercial aircrafts have thrust vectoring mechanisms? As we discussed, generally for the transport or civil aircrafts, we don't go for the thrust vectoring. We will not have any nozzles for the thrust vectoring. But for the fighters, especially combat vehicles, where we need the very short space to take off and land, then where we need the very quick maneuvering, there we go for the thrust vectors. For commercial civil engines, we don't go for the thrust vectoring. The other question is, fluid thrust vector is nothing but hydraulic control. Hydraulic in the sense it's a fluid, as the name says, it's through the fluid only. So there is no actuation system. Only thing is, in addition to the primary jet, we will inject some additional fluid. That way it is hydraulic. It's not, we don't have any hydraulic actuation system there. We are playing with another jet. You have the two jets there. Any other questions? You can see here, this is the one jet, basically one jet, and surrounding that jet you are putting another jet. You are not really changing the shape of the nozzle and all. you are not at all changing. Only thing is you are making some separation. Because of this secondary jet, this main jet will change the direction. Main jet will change it. It gets changed actually. Suppose you are sending the fluid like this, probably the jet will lean to bottom. Here, these will not change. Geometry will not change. Geometry of the nozzle will not change. Only thing is the fluid direction will change by introducing the secondary flow. Yeah, tertiary is the third flow. In addition to the primary, secondary, sometimes you go for the third flow. Generally, we don't really go for the tertiary flows. Majorly for the go with the primary and secondary flows. But sometimes, tertiary flows you can take from the environment. Yeah, this is the mechanical control basically. Here you are changing the nozzle direction. So this is the mechanical control. Fluidic control, you don't change the nozzle direction. Nozzle will be same way, but only thing is you introduce the another jet. Tertiary flow, as I mentioned, basically sometimes you take the jet from the atmosphere, environment basically. Separate dose for that. Or only otherwise at a different location you will introduce. Yeah, you can see here. This is the primary and this is a secondary. And tertiary is, again, there will be some doors basically. When they open the doors, the air from the environment gets into here, gets into this jet. So majorly for the low Mach number and the high thrust, we go for this tertiary air. Any other questions? If there are no questions, let me go further. Thrust reversals, as we mentioned, sometimes, many times, even in commercial aircrafts, during the landing, to reduce the landing length, we go for the thrust reversal. So they, in addition to the brake, mechanical brake, we use the jet brake basically. This is a jet brake. So as the name says, we are reversing the thrust. Okay, instead of the pushing the aircraft, now it tries to put the jet opposite to your aircraft basically. So thereby we get the stop actual. Drag will increase basically. What we do is we increase the drag. So by increasing the drag, it will slow down. Okay, so that's also a kind of the function for the nozzles. So what we do there is we will deflect the exhaust stream to produce the component of the reverse thrust. We'll provide in the additional braking mechanisms. Okay, maybe I will show some pictures, then it will be easier for you to understand that. Discharge angle about 45 degrees. What is discharge angle? I will show in the next picture. So a component of the thrust, you have the forward motion now, forward direction. So that stops the your aircraft. It's basically to stop the, it works like a braking your aircraft. Again, there are the different mechanisms are used, clamshell, bucket type, blocker doors. I will just show you some pictures, then it will be easy for you. But only thing is just by the shape we differentiate. These are the different systems. Okay, clamshell, and the other one is the bucket, external bucket type, and the third one is the blocker doors. Many times for the civil aircrafts, we go for the clamshell and the blocker doors. I will show you some pictures. Okay, a clamshell used in the non-afterburning, as the name says, non-afterburning. That's generally for the commercial aircrafts. Generally, afterburners are majorly used for the fighters, where you need the very high thrust and very high maneuvering and all. So, clamshell generally used for the non-afterburning engines. So, basically, how it works is, we have a pneumatically operating system. It's a kind of doors will rotate. When deployed, doors rotate and deflect the primary jet. I will show some pictures, then it will be easier. Yeah, probably you can see here. This is basically a nozzle. And here we are just trying to open two doors. So the jet will come like this now. Instead of the jet goes like this, it comes like this and it stops. So thrust reversal we say. It's more or less same thing here, but the shape is a little different here. Bucket type here. You can see here, this is the entire engine and the nozzle portion. What happens is before the nozzle, this door will open. So the jet will come here, and it goes like this. So it goes like this. So obviously it tries to stop the engine. Instead of going this way, it goes like this, forward motion. Jet moves in the forward direction because of this deflector. Okay, so it just deflects the air. It deflects the air and the air will move like this. Move like this forward direction. So that will help in reducing the drag, basically. Reducing the thrust force. First of all, you are taking some jet out of the main jet, and you are using that in the reverse direction or forward direction here. So that helps in stopping the engine. Thrust reversal, reversing the thrust. Yeah. Bucket type stream uses the bucket type doors to deflect the gas stream. Reverse door form the part of the convergent divergent nozzle. So convergent divergent nozzle, that's majorly for the fighters, high Mach flights. So that will become the part of the nozzle, but whenever it is required to do the reverse door, then the same portion will convert that as the door, actually reverse door. High bypass, blocker doors, that's majorly for the commercial aircrafts, civil aircrafts, where we use the high bypass turbofans, we use the blocker doors. So blocker doors, what it does is, it stops the bypass basically. The cold bypass flow is deflected to the cascade vanes to achieve the required flow deflection. Hope you understood. here what we do is we have the doors even here. Generally, if I don't have the picture here, but otherwise, generally there will be doors here in between, actually near the bypass, just after the fans. Just after the fans, you will have the doors here, and that will open, and it blocks the flow. So what happens is the jet will come here and it goes forward, as it is having some deflectors, it goes back. So you will have the flow in the forward direction. So obviously, from the Newton's third law, we will get the opposite direction reaction will happen. So that will stop the engine. So thrust reversals generally used for both commercial and the fighter jets. You know, fighter jets, it's more required for within a small distance, they need to come to rest position. Whereas in the commercial, you have the some space actually. So that's very important. But both they will use the reversal system, thrust reversal system. And other thing, very important thing is jet noise. You all know when we introduced the subject, we understood the differences, various differences between the power plants. You know, turbojets earlier we use for the even for the civil aircraft we use turbojets. Nowadays we are not using the turbojet. One major reason is the noise. You all know that. So exhaust nozzle, again, noise of these nozzles is very, very important. We need to have the control the noise. It's a very important topic, and a lot of research is happening in this area. We can't cover completely here, but here just keep in your mind, jet exhaust noise is a major contributor to the overall noise. Okay, noise can be generated from the engine mechanical parts, moving parts, but apart from that, jet exhaust, the noise generated from the jet is a major contributor. So this is we need to control that. There are different ways. One way is, you know, nowadays we are not using the turbojet, we are using the turbofans. You all know that the secondary bypass flow mass is high, but velocities are very less there. So as the velocity reduces, noise will be reduced. I think somewhere it is mentioned your noise is proportional to the fifth power of your velocity. So when you reduce the velocity, noise will be reduced very, very drastically. So one way is using the turbofans, high bypass turbofans. That's the one noise control. But here in the fighter and all, we can't really go for the turbofans there. So there we use the other mechanisms. One is the corrugations. I will just show you the next slide how it looks like. That is one thing. And other thing is mixing the jets. So apart from the core, we will have the some secondary jet which comes in, it's from the ambient. Sometimes it can be taken from the ambient, and that will be mixed. So that mixing helps to reduce the noise. And sometimes noise absorbing materials also we will use. But keep in mind, all these they need to withstand very high temperatures. So this is the corrugations. So you can see here, by having this kind of the corrugations, noise will be controlled, reduced basically. It creates a shear basically. Yeah, I think with that I will close today's session. And before closing, any questions, any clarifications till now? With this we have completed the exhaust nozzle. Even though I have not really covered the aerodynamic part, I hope it is already covered in the your aerodynamic session. Aerodynamics or the fluid mechanics, you could have covered the CD nozzle, the flow through nozzle, and there you could have understood about the pressure ratios with the different pressure ratios, how the flow behaves, flow phenomenon with the different pressure ratios. Critical pressure ratio, over expansion and the under expansion. And other thing is, we covered in the thermodynamics, especially SFEE, steady flow energy equation for the nozzles. So basically we are converting the thermal energy into the kinetic energy. High temperature, high pressure, exhaust gas, when you are sending through the nozzle, you are getting the high velocity jets. In general, the once the jet is coming outside of the your nozzle, it is supposed to become the ambient pressure. So they, you know, different pressure ratios you could have learned in the aerodynamics. If it is not covered, please let me know. Maybe we will cover one session on the, especially on the CD nozzles, converging diverging nozzle, flow through converging diverging nozzle. Otherwise, you can just Google. It's already available. A lot of material is available in the CD nozzle. Why do we need the CD nozzle for getting the supersonic velocities? With the converging nozzles, it's no way. You can't really get the high Mach flows. Please let me know if any questions. Please drop your questions in the live chat. We will go through that. And meanwhile, some announcements, till 14th, government has declared the shutdown. So probably our university also get shut down till 14th. Still, I didn't get the formal announcement. I will send the formal announcement once we get it. But apart from that, mentally get prepared for that. If that is the case, we may not have the sufficient time to get prepared or cover the entire syllabus in the face-to-face classroom lectures. So whatever we are covering here, put some efforts. I request you all to spend 2 to 3 hours at least in a day to go through these presentations and lecture notes, what we are supplying. And get prepared yourself. Any help is required, feel free to call us. All of us are kind of working from home, so feel free in case you need any clarifications. And probably we will give some assignments. You need to work on those assignments and submit the assignments. Probably we may skip one test out of the 3 internal IA test. Actually, we may have the only 2, and the assignment will be treated as one of the those tests. So get prepared for all these things. And again, on the mini projects also, request hope everyone is working on your mini projects. Any clarifications, any difficulties, Any help you require, please call us. Any questions? Yeah, if there are no questions, I will stop here. Once again, thanks for joining. We will continue tomorrow's session on the combustor. So with that, we are going to complete 3 modules. And the 4th and 5th are similar ones, compressors and the turbines. We will that also we will try to cover in the next week. Thanks for joining once again. Take care. Be safe. Don't come outside. Be safe. Thanks a lot. I'm signing off.